Back at the dawn of movie animation, Walt Disney and his team of animators developed techniques to make their animations feel more realistic. Now in 1981, Disney animators Ollie Johnston and Frank Thomas compiled a list of guidelines to share with other animators. They called this doctrine the 12 basic principles of animation, and it's become a standard in animation ever since. Now if you've ever watched virtually any animated film, chances are the animators have used these principles. In this video, I thought it would be fun to apply the 12 principles of animation to acting and show you how you can use each of these guidelines to develop bigger, broader characters and to help magnify your performances so that you can play effectively to the back of a big house. You can use these tools anytime you need more animation in your acting. Join me after the bump. Hi diddly ho, I am Doug Fall. Thank you for watching today. Welcome to Augmented Actor, where we help you augment your acting career with tips, tactics, and tech. If you like what you see today, you might also enjoy the Augmented Actor website. Join the Augmented Actor Facebook page, where you can mingle with other actors from all over the world. Or you can sign up for the Augmented Actor email list and get a free ebook on memorization just for doing so. As always, you can subscribe, follow, like, or share this video on whichever platform you happen to be watching on. Okay, enough of that. The 12 basic principles of animation are based on the work of Disney animators from the 1930s onward. One of the best videos I've seen on the subject was created by Alan Becker for YouTube, and I highly recommend that you check out his video for a better understanding on these principles. It's on your screen right now or down in the description below. So, how can these principles designed for animation be useful to an actor? Well, have you ever watched a video recording of a theater production that you were in and you thought to yourself, man, I thought I was being really big, but it looks like I was just standing there? Or, no wonder that joke didn't land because so-and-so was doing something else and they weren't even paying any attention to me. Things like this happen all the time when you work in large theaters, or even in small stages or in film. You think you're delivering a great performance, but because the audience is so far away, it doesn't register to them in the way that you intended it to. Now in real life, we experience exaggerations all the time, but then we get on stage and we go into acting mode and we tend to stiffen up. And we display controlled expressions and movements because we think we need to stay in character. We don't want it to be too big because then it'll look like we're mugging or overacting. And as a result, we can deliver stiffer and less convincing performances. So let's see what we can glean from each of these principles of animation. And I'll explain each principle, and then I'll show you how you can apply these principles to your characters when you're developing them. And just so you know, these aren't gonna apply in all situations, especially if you're working in a serious, intimate film or in a smaller house. However, anytime you need to play broad comedy or come up with exaggerated character choices, these principles will help. So let's get started. Principle number one, squash and stretch. The purpose of squash and stretch in animation is to give a sense of weight and flexibility to objects. For instance, if you animate a bouncing ball and you just keep the shape of the ball the same throughout, it will appear very stiff and unnatural. When you look at a real ball bouncing, there is a small amount of squashing as it hits the ground and stretching as it accelerates up or down. If you add this squashing and stretching to your animation, it makes the ball look more realistic. The more you squash and stretch, the more it emphasizes the object's speed, momentum, weight, and mass. The heavier and stiffer an object is, the less squash and stretch it'll have. Now, squash and stretch not only applies to objects, but it can also apply to the musculature of your face or the overall movements of a body in motion. Now, when you're acting, you can play around with squash and stretch whenever you have to project your facial movements to the back of a large house. Take, for instance, an expression of surprise. You could just go from a neutral expression to a surprised look, but to add more animation to the expression, try squashing your face just a little bit before the expression, and then stretching beyond the expression, and then relaxing into the expression. You'll notice that there are a lot of comedic actors with squashy and stretchy faces. Don Knotts is a good example. And so is Jim Carrey.
I'm sure you already knew that. That's what turns me on about you. your attention to detail.
Squash and stretch also helps you when you're dancing or doing broad movements. If you can think of each jump as squashing a little bit lower and stretching up a little bit higher, then it'll add that much more power to the movement. Now, when you're dancing, it always takes extra energy to pull off squashing and stretching, so make sure you're warmed up. So take a look at these two examples of the opening choreography to a chorus line. Now, the first video is from a very competent high school production. They perform the choreography well, but with very little squash and stretch.
5, 6, 7, 8!
And the second video is from the Broadway cast of the Tony Awards.
5, 6, 7, 8!
Now notice their choreography includes a little bit extra squash and a lot of extra stretch. Their dancing looks much more animated, especially when watching from the back row of the theater. Now I ain't dissing on those high school kids. They pulled off the original choreography from A Chorus Line brilliantly. By incorporating squash and stretch into your facial expressions and movements, you will appear more animated, more energetic, and more flexible to an audience. Principle number 2, anticipation. Anticipation helps communicate actions to an audience by preparing them for the action. In animation, we see this when a character pulls back his arm before punching, or they wind their body up right before running.
To exit stage right.
The more you can indicate to an audience what the character is about to do, the more the audience will notice the action and the more effective the action will be. When a character is about to jump in an animation, before leaping off the ground, the character must first squat down. Jumping without the squat feels unrealistic. When acting, you can use this principle to make your movements clear to an audience by directing your attention toward the action before taking the action. For instance, you might need to slap someone on stage. Now, if you suddenly reach up and slap them, the audience might miss the action. But if you raise your hand up behind your head prior to taking the swing, you give the audience the anticipation that the slap is about to happen. Now, it may not be something you would do in real life, because in real life you would not want to give the other person any indication that you're about to slap them. But in order to convey the story to the audience, you may need to add anticipatory movements. So another example, pretend you're going to steal an item off of a table and put it in your pocket. Now, in real life, you would do this as subtly as possible. But in theater, you need to make sure the audience sees it. So first you might turn your head and notice the object. You might make an expression of interest and then turn away from the object. You might attempt to reach for the object and then give up. And finally, you might visibly raise your hand and then take the object and make sure we see you put it in your pocket. Adding anticipation adds clarity to your movement. Principle number 3. Staging. Staging is all about presenting an idea so that it is completely and unmistakably clear to an audience. It involves blocking, timing, lighting, camera framing, and setting, as well as choices in your character traits and actions. You want to make sure that your audience knows where to look, and that each important action happens in the clear. You also want to make sure that your reactions to what another character is doing happen separately from their actions. Now, if you want to convey a certain mood with your sets and costumes, then make it very apparent. If the environment needs to be very rundown, make it super rundown. If your character is super rich and famous, give them quality clothing and a regal posture. In theater acting, it is mostly on the director or choreographer to create the staging, but it's important for an actor to know how they fit into the bigger picture of each scene. If you've ever been accused of drawing focus or upstaging another actor, then you are guilty of breaking the principles of staging. Principle number 4, straight ahead and pose to pose. In animation, this describes two different ways of animating movement. Straight ahead is when the animator draws each frame of an animation in order from start to finish. If you've ever seen one of those cartoon flipbooks, they use this style. This style of animation is very effective for natural simulations like fire, smoke, and water splashes, because the animation is very fluid in nature. An actor trying to use straight ahead animation principles would be fine-tuning everything as you go from start to finish, and this isn't always the easiest way to work. This may represent how you work when you're actually running through a show, however, or like when you're staging a fight scene to ensure that you're safe. In the pose-to-pose method, you break an animated sequence into a few keyframes. You set your character's starting and ending poses, and then you add a few key poses throughout until you perfect the movement that the character is going to make. And then you fill in the in-between frames after that. This style of animation creates a more controlled animation, and it allows you to perfect and time the actions before animating them. Now, in acting, there's not a lot we can glean from this principle. But for a director, this might help you with staging a show or a scene. You can solve the problem of where you want your actors to start and finish, and then you can add a few key pictures and then block them to fill in the details of how the characters move from one picture to the next. Now, an actor can also break down their own blocking in this manner. A dancer can break down a series of movements into poses and then figure out the moves that they need to get from one pose to the next. It's a broad strokes method of creating a scene. That's it for this video. In the next video, I will continue with principles 5 through 8, so make sure you look for that either on your screen right now or down in the YouTube description below. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.